Recorded Books presents Mennonite Valley Girl, A Wayward Coming of Age by Carla Funk. Narrated by the author. For every female in the family, far and wide, and for Soupy and Cindy, my fellow valley gals. Why do you boast in the valleys, your flowing valley, O backsliding daughter? Jeremiah 49:4a. Writing a memoir is a little like Testimony Sunday. Every so often in the church of my childhood, the preacher would invite folks to come forward and give a testimony. Eventually, after a long and awkward silence, someone would walk slowly to the front of the sanctuary, stand at the microphone, and start to testify. The one who spoke might share a few words meant to bless, or give thanks, or a praise report of a minor miracle occurring in our midst. Sometimes the person told a true and simple story, confessing weakness, doubt, or the missing of the mark. Those sitting in the pews might whisper to each other, "Here she goes again," or "That's not what I heard happened," or "What must her poor mother think?" Those listening might shift in their seats as they found their own stories flashing back to them. Yes, the one giving testimony likely changed some names and altered some identifying details to shield others from shame. She most certainly didn't tell the whole story, because some parts just weren't meant to be laid bare. Memory, like the heart, is prone to wander and full of flaws. But to tell the story with love and honesty, that's the hope. And to point toward a bigger, higher, wilder story that illuminates the valleys we pass through and the shadows that follow us as we stumble our way out into the light. Flashlight tag. As soon as the summer sky deepened into dusk, we huddled in a circle and set the rules for the night. From the far side of the yard to where the driveway met the asphalt, from the pig pen to the tree fort, but not beyond the lagoon, and only to the tree line, our boundaries fell into place, marking out the limits for our game. Home base was where we started, gathered to the garage light's glow. On a patch of gravel flanked by flower beds, we stood, my brother and a straggle of boys from down the road, and me and the girls from the house next door. Above our heads, a wind chime silvered the air, and around our ankles, the cat wove and wound its tail. "Who's going to be it?" my brother said. No one volunteered, and so we made our fists and held them to the center of our circle, ready for the choosing. One potato, two potato, or eeny, meeny, miny, mo, or engine, engine, number 9, going down to Chicago line, which the boys seemed to like best because it threatened with a train going off the tracks. The one who spoke the rhyme counted off the words until a final fist was landed on and an it was picked. It, a snitch of a word, held everything we didn't know but wanted to. In a single syllable, all the hidden secrets of the universe distilled, and all our future knowledge waited to be found. Did you see it? Did you hear about it? She did it. He did it. They did it. It's true. It was the nutshell of our innocence and our hunger for experience. It named the shape of darkness, but not what cast the shadow. "You're it," my brother said. He handed me the flashlight, which was the only consolation. The one who held the light held power. To sweep the beam across a blackened panorama and find a flicker in the trees, an eyeball's shine, the neon of a shoelace, or the glint of metal bracing someone's smile, that was the mission. I shut my eyes and started counting to 100, calling the numbers with a breath between each 1, 2, 3, 4, giving time for everyone to scatter. Though we were old enough to stay awake past dark, past when our parents went to sleep, We turned into children all over again as soon as the game began. Hollering and running through the trees, wielding sticks by moonlight, yelling curses at each other, and laughing across the acres, we could have been kids with our t-shirts whipped off, barefoot, flying wild. But now we ran with a different voltage humming in our blood, a current that sizzled in the company of other bodies. The boys were fleet and lean, all muscle and energy. They launched up trees and laddered the branches to enviable heights, while we girls stayed lower to the ground, taught to be careful in our climbing. "Ready or not, here I come," I called into the night. I flicked on the flashlight. When I was a child, the whole earth was filled with glory. Even a slug sluicing a path of slime across the greenhouse glass was a marvel to behold. The how and why of awe and curiosity fueled my thinking. I looked at the sky and wanted to know the names of what shone in it. I crouched to the dirt and studied weeds. I plucked the delicate tubes from the stalks of Indian paintbrush, sucked the nectars from their tips, and tasted the candy of what grew wild in my own backyard. But as the body grows up farther from the ground, so the shadow lengthens. Wonder, with its soft underbelly, retreats. It goes into hiding, hushes in the dark, until the faith of childhood sounds more like a scoff than a song. The light-filled eye that scanned the dust for gold turns inward, heats up. The body, that original house of wonder, warps and swells, holding what waits to be revealed. I kept my footsteps slow, stalking with the flashlight held low as I listened for the silence to give up its mysteries. From somewhere farther down the road, a dog barked, its echo like a stone in water rippling. Above me, a hydro line buzzed. I swept the beam across the yard, illuminating the logging truck parked in front of my dad's shop. The chrome of the smokestacks gleamed. My body was no longer small enough to hide inside the wheel well of the truck's tire or wedge between the mud flaps so that my clothes and hair took on the grease and oil, sawdust and dirt, those smells driven back from the bush and clear cut, that world of men and their machines. Now the trailer was empty, unhitched, and the engine lay cold. Somewhere behind me, in the back bedroom of the house, my father lay snoring, my mother beside him, two cleaving sleepers bound by vows. A snicker from somewhere in the garden swung my flashlight over and across. The seeds my mother planted weeks before grew up in tidy rows, nameable now as what they would become. The carrots with their feathery heads, the clovery leaves of radishes, the thin sword tips of onions, and the potatoes sunk down in darkness, busting through with green. Around the corner of the greenhouse, a shape in motion, I aimed my beam. "I see you," I hollered, but couldn't name the body, which had started now to run for the safety of home base. If that body was a boy, his speed would beat me there. But if it was a girl, I had a shot. "Soupy?" I called. "Leonard? Teresa? Richard?" An eye above me, leaning low toward the earth, might have seen a single spark moving at the edges of the town. A small town poured into a northern valley full of shadows. The way a matchbox holds its future fire, my hometown held me, too, with all the elements essential for the flame. Inside its limits, inside the sameness and smallness of the place that once stoked wonder, inside a valley carved and bound by the river's bend and flow, I was ready to be shaken free, taken out. Inside a body whose bloodline sang an old, old gospel, inside a body shifting in its flesh and frame, I was learning how to burn, and what to burn, and what to keep. Another body at my back began to move, and another rose from trees at the bottom of the driveway's slope, and then we all were running, breathing heat in the rules of our game, a game passed down to us from a time when light had been a fire, a torch held up to mark the way. Through the garden dirt I ran, trying not to kill what grew there, leaning toward the home-free glow above the garage. Around me, beside me, and flying ahead, shadows morphed to bodies, sweat and skin, becoming my brother and the boys from down the road and the neighbor girls too, all of us breathing hard and racing for the light. The Kingdom. The men stayed rooted on the back porch in the shade, far enough away from the kitchen so that the women who were preparing the Father's Day meal wouldn't complain about the smell of their smoke. Some uncles leaned against the stucco siding. Others sat on the steps with their knees bent at odd angles, their pant cuffs riding up and the white flesh above their socks glowing. My father flicked his Bic to the tip of his cigarette, then held it out to Uncle Corny, then Uncle Jake, passing down the line until all the men were breathing from the same flame. On my mother's side of the family, cigarettes belonged in the same category as playing cards and alcohol, forbidden vices. But in the Funk kingdom, smoking was a sanctioned sin. Because Grandpa Funk had been a smoker, the habit drifted to my dad and his brothers without judgment, most of them sneaking out behind the barn to light up when they were barely teenagers. A few Christmases back, Grandma Funk had given all her sons and sons-in-law the same gift, a tin of tobacco and a home rolling machine, ordered from the Sears Christmas catalog. After the roast turkey and ham feast, the men had sat at the dining room table loading tobacco into the filtered tubes and cranking out cigarettes with the quiet intensity of factory workers. Now, in the breezy warmth of a Sunday in June, their conversation was punctuated by the tapping of ashes into the communal tin can resting on the top step. Their smoke rose to crown them with a vapor that hung a moment, then wafted away. They talked of work, life at bush camp, which logging outfit was first in the loading line, who'd bought new trucks and for what price. Their speech moved in and out of Plattdeutsch, that cobbled low German spoken by peasants and Mennonites. Grandpa and Grandma Funk lived on the north side of the river at the top of P and H Hill, so named for P and H Auto Supplies, which was situated at the crest of a short, steep section of Loop Road. If I stood in their driveway, I could see across to where the shop fixed vehicles and sold ice cream sandwiches from a grubby chest freezer for 45 cents. On summer days, Grandma would fold the coins into our palms when Grandpa wasn't watching, then whisper for us to go buy ourselves a treat. Past P and H lay Great-Grandpa Martin's house, where we butchered pigs and chickens every autumn, gatherings that had seemed in childhood like a holiday, but now dragged on as long hours of work that left me smelling like blood and innards and smoke. North of the house, up another gravel road, lay the wrecking yard full of old cars and trucks, rows and heaps of metal exoskeletons rusting in various states of dismantlement and decay. Only the boys ever made it all the way to the wrecking yard. While we waited to be called in for lunch, my brother and the other teenage males ripped up the hill on their BMX bikes, sneaking away with their stash of PVC pipe and drugstore saltpeter to see what they might blow up. The men smoked, the women cooked. The little cousins tore back and forth across the grass, chasing each other and the dogs with willow sticks, falling down, crying, getting back up, and tearing off again. A few stands of scrappy birch and poplar trees flanked the yard, and along the edges of the large vegetable garden, raspberry canes and saskatoon and gooseberry bushes grew, flush with fruit that would be picked, washed, and cooked into jellies and jams, baked into pies, or tucked into pockets of soft dough that were deep-fried, then dusted with sugar. These were our Rollküchen, a staple of the Mennonite kitchen, which were either filled with berries or eaten plain as simple strips of dough fried to a golden crisp in a simmering pan of lard. The proper way to eat Rollküchen was to hold a slice of salted watermelon in one hand and a piece of the fried dough in the other, alternating one bite from the melon and one from the rollkuchen, which is what the uncles would do later, after they'd eaten lunch and played a few rounds of horseshoes on the back pitch. Then Grandma and the aunts would carry out a huge stainless steel bowl of watermelon slices and a plate of still hot rollkuchen resting on a bed of paper towels damp with grease. The men would descend, followed by their offspring, and then the women would clean up what remained. Grandpa and Grandma's property, though too small to ever be a working farm, had a scattering of sheds and outbuildings behind the house, including the old cabin where they once lodged boarders to earn extra income. In one of Grandma's black-and-white photographs, a man smiled up from a bed that looked like a small makeshift Conestoga wagon. The young bachelor had suffered a broken back, Grandma explained, and so had come to stay with them until he learned to walk again. Oh, but he could build toys, Grandma said. One of the other boarders had rigged up the man's bed with a small motor so he could cruise around the property on his own, collecting tools and lumber scraps for his building projects. In the photograph, he lay on his stomach, holding a wooden dollhouse he had made, a gift for one of the girls, but which one, Grandma couldn't remember. On the Funk side, I was the only female my age. Below me, the younger girls still played with the dolls and toys pulled from Grandma's cupboards, and the older ones had already graduated from high school, gone off to college, started full-time jobs in town, or had boyfriends who'd become husbands who'd soon make them pregnant. I was somewhere in between those worlds, meandering from room to room, trying to avoid being handed a baby, or an apron, or a wooden spoon. I knew my inheritance. The Mennonite story stretched over continents and centuries and involved a lot of Bolsheviks, borscht, harsh winters, and fleeing one place for the next in search of freedom. History's slow-release chase scene with a persecuting government in pursuit. That was one way of explaining the feeling that moved through me and left me wandering inside and out, standing at the edge of the men and their hazy laughter, then bored, turning back to the house. At the stove, at the sink, at the counters, peeling, slicing, stirring, and mixing, the women moved in the practiced choreography of the communal kitchen. Aunt Agnes poured a warm, sweet, creamy dressing over a bowl of shredded iceberg, her classic wilted lettuce salad. Aunt Marge stood over the steaming ham, carving slices onto a platter. Aunt Mary whisked the saucepan full of schmaltfat, a thickened salt-and-pepper cream gravy to pour over the vranikya, which Grandma was making especially for the meal. Vranikya were our Mennonite pierogies. While some families filled theirs with various kinds of meat or potato mash, the Funks filled them with either chopped fruit or with glums, dry cottage cheese. I couldn't bite into glums without thinking of the pitted, cleft flesh of a woman's thigh and buttocks, as if Mennonite aunts and grandmas and moms had given themselves and their cellulite to the making of the food. Whenever I tried to swallow a mouthful, my eyes watered and my throat threatened to seize, but my dad and all his siblings, even my brother and my cousins, held up their plates for seconds when the glums, vranikya, were passed around the table. In assembly line fashion, Grandma rolled out the soft sour cream dough, cut circles from it with the mouth of a glass tumbler, then dropped a spoonful of the cottage cheese mixture onto each round of dough. She wet her fingers in a dish of water, tapped them around half the rim of the dough circle, then folded it into a pocket and pinched the edges to seal it shut. Into a large pot of boiling water, she dropped the pockets. When they floated to the surface, she scooped them out and set them on a rack. Before she was Grandma Funk, she was my dad's mother. And before that, she was Annie Martin's, a teenage bride who, at the wedding altars, I will honor and obey, became Mrs. Henry Funk, her name sliding behind his name the way it did for all Mennonite women who married. But to me, she was Grandma Funk. Sometimes Grossmama. Always soft-bodied in a polyester dress sewn from the same pattern in various colors and prints. Always wearing thick beige pantyhose and plain black lace-up shoes. She combed her thin hair straight back from her round face and wide forehead and wore it rolled at the nape of her neck. A black mesh cap, bobby-pinned in place, covered her head. Her glasses magnified the watery blueness of her eyes. When she hugged me and pressed the smooth velvet of her cheek against my own, I smelled the rose scent of the talcum powder she sprinkled down the bodice of her dress. "Oh, bah," she said, when a toddler cousin ran to her with a scraped knee. She scooped up the crying child, took his clenched fist and unfolded it, and then began to count off each finger with a rhyme whose words in Low German sounded like yidda yidda yacha and had something to do with a family of mice getting their heads chopped off with a knife. "This and one, and this and one, and this and one," she'd count, pinching the tip of each little finger, and finally ending with a tickle in the center of the child's palm, followed by a chuck under the chin. His scraped knee forgotten, the child sniffed, wriggled out of Grandma's arms, and headed back to the other cousins, still running in the yard with their pointed sticks aimed high. Though it had been over 6 months since he died, the ghost of Grandpa Funk seemed to linger in his corner of the dining room, a washed-out gray shadow wavering in and out of optic memory. Before the sickness, the diagnosis, and even in the months of treatment that followed, he sat at the head of the table with a blanket or quilt spread out before him. With fingers still yellowed from the decades of cigarettes, he tied off the tufts of yarn stitched to hold the wool filling in place between the two sheets of fabric. Coughing and clearing his throat, sipping his weak coffee, he knotted the yarn methodically, with the same precision he demanded in all aspects of his home and property. When he'd returned from Vancouver, skinny and gray-faced after another stint of radiation, he brought back a cardboard box full of stuffed animals he'd made in the arts and crafts wing of the Cancer Pavilion. He arranged them on a shelf of the glass-doored cabinet in the living room so that a lineup of bear, dog, cat, lamb, and skunk looked out through the door. On the shelves above and below Grandpa's plush menagerie, Uncle Pete's models were displayed, hand-painted race cars and hot rods, and a Harley chopper ridden by a scythe-wielding Grim Reaper. "What are you going to do with the stuffed animals?" I'd asked Grandpa, angling for dibs on the skunk with a fat white stripe down its back.
"I'm going to keep them," he said. "These are not toys what for playing with."
He clicked the glass door shut. That was his way, to set the rules and expect others to obey. When Grandma needed to buy new underwear, he had her tally the cost to the very cent, including tax, and then into her open palm, he counted out the exact change for the purchase. I'd heard my dad say words like stingy and cheap, and tell stories of how, as a boy, he had to give his own father 90 cents of every dollar he earned at the dairy farm. As a 4-year-old, I'd stood with my brother in the doorway of our grandparents' bathroom and listened to Grandpa Funk preach a stern sermon on how best to clean ourselves after using the toilet. He tore 2 squares of tissue from the roll and dangled them in front of us. "This is all what you need," he said. He showed us how to fold the tissue in half to make another clean surface after the first wipe. Then he folded it again in half, and yet again, until the paper was as small as a sugar packet. "This way," he said, "you can wipe and wipe and still have it clean." When I complained to Grandma, she clucked her tongue and whispered permission for us to use that what we needed. And then she told me how no one had any toilet paper when she was a girl. "All what we had was old catalogues," she said, "and oh, bah, how that gave us the piles." To avoid getting hemorrhoids, she stole the cuffs of old shirts from the rag bag whenever she was on mending duty. She saved all the fabric in a secret stash and took the rags with her to the outhouse. "And that was better for wiping," she said, "so much softer." Even after Grandpa Funk died, his animals stayed locked in the cabinet, memorabilia of his final year on Earth. Grandma couldn't bear to give them away.
I didn't understand how she could have loved him so devotedly, this man who only seemed to smile when someone else was crying. When he pinched and twisted the top of my brother's ear and made him plead, ow, 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 for him to quit. When he force-fed the sharpest aged cheddar to a fussing toddler who gagged and spat it out. When my little cousin was tricked into eating hot Mexican peppers and then grabbed at his tongue and wheezed. Then, oh, then Grandpa laughed and laughed, and the laughter of my dad and his brothers followed, all of them crowding around whatever joke or mild injury had occurred. When the neighbor's dog slunk into Grandpa and Grandma's backyard and tried to pick a fight with Uncle George's pooch, the men caught the stray, grabbed it by the tail, and scrubbed its backside with a wire brush dipped in turpentine. The dog howled a chain of high-pitched vowels and dragged its butt along the grass, then streaked home yelping, while Grandpa stood on the top of the back porch, glittery-eyed and grimacing with laughter, his sons echoing below him on the steps. When I studied my dad's face, I saw more of his mother than his father. Like hers, his eyes blurred behind thick lenses, and he had to lean in close to see the words on any page. He was softer at the edges, too, always reaching into his shirt pocket for a mint to coax one of the toddlers onto his knee. He pinched the fat cheeks of babies, but gently, and did not make them cry on purpose. He fed the dog scraps of fat from his plate, and whenever his own father challenged him to a game of snooker at the basement billiards table, he knew not to boast if he beat him, and if Grandpa missed a shot, never to crack a laugh. Before the funeral, in the foyer of the Gospel Chapel, Grandma stood alone at Grandpa's open casket, sniffling into her tissue. Head bowed, she looked into the coffin for a long moment, like she might be double-checking he was dead. No ribcage rise and fall, no whistle from the lips. Slowly, my aunts and uncles joined her, gathering around the body of their father on display. Aunt Agnes, Aunt Mary, and Aunt Marge dabbed their eyes. The uncles loudly blew their noses into handkerchiefs. My dad sat beneath the coat rack, red-eyed, and shuddering with sobs over a man who hadn't ever seemed to like him, his firstborn son. When I took my turn at the coffin, inching forward with my brother and mom, I saw a black-suited, gray-faced, gaunt-cheeked man with owlish eyebrows that even in death made him look mad. I tried to summon a memory to turn the moment warm, but all I could picture was Grandpa Funk back in his living room with his ashtray beside him as he puffed on a home-rolled smoke, his eyes forever fixed on the TV in the corner, Wild Kingdom flashing its animals on the prowl. Even as I studied the Funks, I couldn't find where I fit. Not with the boys and their slingshots, not with the older girl cousins in their fresh perms and sheer pantyhose, not with the women in the kitchen wearing aprons and wielding knives, and not with the men outside who were waiting to be called and served and satisfied. "Zusa," said Uncle George, calling from his spot on the porch. I was too old for the childhood nickname, a play on my middle name, Sue, and the low German word for sugar. But it was better than what the uncles called my brother, Pudelhund, which, as far as I could tell, had something to do with poodles or a puddle of dog pee. I sat down and scratched Pulo, Uncle George's dog. "Sing, Pulo," said Uncle George. "Come on. You sing, Pulo." Soon all the uncles were joining in, ordering the squat, black and tan dog to perform his famous trick. As if unable to bear the men's chanted demands any longer, Pulo cocked back his head and shut his eyes. Mournfully, operatically, he sang, and then sang some more, howling so loudly the smallest cousins clamped their hands over their ears and begged Uncle George to make the dog stop. "Come and eat," one of the aunts called through the back door that opened to the porch stoop. As my dad and his brothers and all the cousins filed in from the yard, the women carried huge bowls and platters of food to the long stretch of cloth-covered tables. Crowded around the edges of the dining room, we stood, and then Grandma looked to Uncle George, the signal for him to start the song of our mealtime prayer. Our voices joined with his in a choral rendition that sounded like talking set to music, the words descending and ascending in their familiar tune. After the drawn-out, monotone Amen, Grandma unclasped her hands and motioned to the laden table. "And now we will eat." She waited for us all to find our seats, and then she moved to the head of the table, where Grandpa Funk always sat at mealtime, where he had sat last Father's Day and the Father's Day before, all the way back through the years to their first table in their first home as man and wife. They had been so poor, she told me, living in a one-room log cabin, but always God had been faithful, and always he had provided. She'd birthed 9 children, including 2 sets of twins, and even while pregnant, she helped in the farm fields and cooked and cleaned for the boarders who lived out back. Yes, sometimes the air had been so cold in winter, the wet diapers froze when they hit the bucket, but all the babies survived. Though Grandma clucked her tongue and shook her head whenever my dad and his brothers drank on the back steps, she never scolded. Grandpa had been harsh enough with them all those years, and now she was ushering in a more peaceful realm. Once, when I asked her why she'd married Grandpa in the first place, she tilted her head a little and shrugged. Back in a small farming community in Saskatchewan, they'd met at the Mennonite church. He had been a sickly young man with lung trouble. He had been quiet and serious. Oh, but he would worry, Grandma said. She had felt so bad for him. I don't remember her saying anything about falling in love. After the veranica and ham and salad and buns, the women cleared the tables and the men took to the porch again. Hunkered on the steps, the uncles picked at their teeth with wooden toothpicks and resumed their truck talk in a pattern of silence, wisecrack, low laughter, and exclamations of Deutschland, the mildest of Mennonite cuss words. They wore their sideburns long, their square, metal-rimmed glasses tinted to keep out the sun. They slicked back their hair into ducktails. They slid out their dentures to get rid of a stuck berry seed or fleck of ham. They blew their noses loudly into handkerchiefs. They were good men, loyal men, steadfast men who stood their ground. They whetted the stone, scraped the blade, swung the axe, loaded the gun, pulled the trigger. They held the keys and steered the wheel. They told us where we needed to go, and they took us there when they decided it was time. In the kitchen, the women scraped and washed and dried the dishes, flush-cheeked and sweating in the steam and heat. But their voices chimed with the camaraderie of females and shone like the sunlight through the thin curtains that draped the window above the sink. These were women with short hair and perms, women who wore pants, whose husbands smoked. These were women who opened their Bibles every morning for a proverb or a psalm, and in the evenings after their children were in bed, watched Love Boat or Magnum P.I. while hemming a pair of pants or crocheting a baby blanket. They were women a little bit in the world, but not fully of it, standing on the threshold of the ancient and the new. Standing in the doorway that led from the kitchen onto the porch and out into the yard, I could smell the yeasty tang of beer as my father and uncles cracked open their bottles. The older boys were already wandering up the road. The shrill voices of children volleyed back and forth through the trees, across the lawn. The shape of things to come lay before me and behind. I could not imagine joining myself to any other clan, but I knew the story unfolding for me. Every few months, our church bulletin printed the wedding bands announcing new pairs, the union of a Friesen and a Froese, a Giesbrecht and a Weeb, a Thiessen and a Dick, who'd soon become one flesh, the bride with her gauzy veil and watery eyes stepping into the arms of her stiff and sweating groom. One day, my body would be carried over the threshold of a different house, seated at a table full of strangers, and offered a drink from someone else's cup. What began as the mingling of one man and one woman would multiply to build a kingdom, seeded in the frozen fields, planted in the prairie dust, and blooming on the north side of the river. Namesake. My father wanted to name me Edna, after some hot chick he knew in his fast car days. I pictured him at the wheel of his convertible Ford Fairlane and her riding shotgun, shrieking around every hairpin curve, a gauzy scarf tied over her hairsprayed bouffant to guard against the wind. With every rev of the pedal, my father would eye Edna and take in her starlit beauty, tucking away her name like a token for the daughter who'd become me. "It's an old lady name," I told my dad. "Someone's grandma's name." I scoffed at the sound of it. Edna, two syllables performing a nasal thud. A name whose music conjured a thick-waisted grouse-mama shuffling across a muddy field, her hair cinched in a bun, a black kerchief knotted beneath her chin. "Nothing wrong with the name Edna," he always argued. "It's a good name, a pretty name." And then his eyes got that misty, far-off look, as if he were back behind the wheel of that ragtop Ford with a beehived beauty beside him and 45 vinyl records spinning on his dashboard stereo, the song skipping with every pothole in the road. My mother had favored the name Shanna Lynn, but my dad nixed it before it could stick. Too flouncy, too fancy, too strange. "How about Karen?" my mom said to him. "How about Corrine?" Those names, too, fell away until I was the name that she gave me. "It means strong and womanly," she told me, showing me the entry in a book of names and their meanings. Strong and womanly sounded like my grandma Shank, my mom's mother, a tall, large-boned lady who pinned her gray hair back into a bun and always wore a dress, even when she rode horseback or butchered the moose Grandpa hauled home from his hunting trips. Strong and womanly sounded like an apron tied around my waist, a knife in my pocket, my rightful female inheritance. My mom couldn't remember what made her choose the name. It shunned the traditional catalog of Mennonite possibilities, ensuring that I wouldn't be lost in a sea of Marys, Sarahs, and Anns. Plus, she didn't know anyone who had ever named their baby Carla, so that seemed like reason enough. But beyond its familiarity, I felt no connection to my name. It was a two-syllable cue, like the name assigned to any creature used to beckon me to the table, in from the woods, away from the fire, out from behind my locked bedroom door. "Carla," my mom's voice called down hallways and out the window and across the acres. "Carla Sue." Sue. A name whose exclamation sounded like a hog farmer hollering to his herd. "Sue-y," my brother would call, and then punctuate with pig snorts. Sue. A name passed down from my mom, who shared it as her middle name. Before her, Sue belonged to her mother's mother, an Amish bride from Kansas. That single syllable, like a bead on a strand, threaded me to a line of females who came before. From the womb, I was stitched to a kinfolk by that name. In great-grandma Sue glowed the egg that bore my mother, and in my mother glowed the egg of me. Down through the generations, each female body opened up to yield a replica from within. Like a row of nesting dolls, their shapes soft-hipped and squat from centuries of pulling weeds and bearing children. Passed down from mother to daughter, the name heirloomed me into a long line of women praised for flaky pie crusts, bountiful gardens, covered heads, held tongues, sharpened knives, and bread dough that baked into risen golden loaves. My name also bound me to a faith whose inheritance was God, whose bloodline was heaven, and whose origin was eternity. Before I was a daughter, before I lay swaddled in the arms of a woman whose gray-green eyes sparked like spring and fire, before a man who smelled like whiskey, smoke, and sawdust bounced me on his knee, before I was the kid sister of a boy whose hands loaded bullets in the barrel and pulled back the slingshot's stone, I was an elsewhere dreamed-up creature, unspooled from a glittering realm and knitted by hands that already knew my name. If I shut my eyes and gave myself to the brooding dark, I could imagine my way back into that making, see myself being scooped up from a genesis of cells and elements, raked from the clay-heavy dirt, same dirt that fed the roots of Douglas fir and aspen, black spruce and silver birch, jack pine and lodgepole, same dirt that fattened rose hips and pussy willows, shot up into dogwood and kinnikinick, sweetened to wild strawberries, huckleberries, and clusters of dusty saskatoons. In that dirt, I rested like a thought not yet fully formed, until, like a light turned on in a dark room, like breath breaking through the skin of deep water, the voice said, "Wake up. Open your eyes. Look at where you come from." Above me, sky and sky and sky forever. Poplar trees in a flush of green, blowing a song that rushed like water, tethering itself to the river's own singing. The current flashing with sockeye and chinook, char and Dolly Vardens and rainbow trout in their iridescent swim. The black-capped chickadee, the crow, robin, cedar waxwing, bluebird, Canada goose, and trumpeter swan, they mingled their sounds to a raucous choir taking flight, rising to blue. Down low, where I waited in the dirt, honeybees fizzed in the fireweed. On the leaves, swallowtails and skippers, coppers and whites, flexed their gauzy wings. "Carla Sue," my mother's voice called, "wake up." Behind my bedroom door, I lay beneath a wool comforter. I opened my eyes to another morning, blinked to clear the blur. My walls were painted a breezy sky blue, except for one accent wall paneled in faux wood. I ran my fingers along a groove in the panel, letting the skin catch on the roughness. If I reached high enough, I could touch the edges of a Garfield picture tacked to the wall, the orange cartoon cat smiling with a missing front tooth and his paws in boxing gloves. The words, "Reach out and touch someone," bubbled above his smug head. On each wall, a different poster with a different inspirational saying, "You're no bunny till some bunny loves you," above a photo of a floppy-eared rabbit. A prayer for God's help above the image of a gerbil squatting in a grassy field. A proverb on friendship beside a kitten perched on a monkey's head. When I sat up in bed, the mirror on my dresser gave back the creature of myself, shape-shifting into someone new, not quite young woman, but more than girl. I flopped back to my pillow. "I'm awake," I called back to my mother's voice. "I'm getting up right now." Outside, the world was sunlight at my window. When I drew the vinyl curtains back, I could see the greenhouse and the backyard garden, and beyond them, past the trees, the pig pen, the sewage lagoon, and my father's shop. Parked in front of it, his pickup, and lower on the stretch of gravel that ran toward the woodshed, one of his Kenworth logging trucks. He no longer drove the trucks. Now he hired other men to haul the logs out of the bush and to the mill. Now he only monkey wrenched, ordered parts, kept the wood pile stacked, and the shop fridge stocked with booze and Pepsi. Past the logging truck and through the stretch of pine and birch and poplar was my best friend Soupy's house, or what had been her house until she moved up the highway to a new property with a bigger house, a hot tub, and a swimming pool carved into the ground. Once summer came, I'd be floating on an inflatable island, bronzing in the heat like a sunbather on a California beach. At Soupy's house, when we weren't goofing around in the pool, we watched as much MTV as we wanted, cranked the volume and sang along to Glass Tiger and Bryan Adams, Haywire and Honeymoon Suite. Only a few summers before, we'd spent our hours together playing with Strawberry Shortcake and My Little Pony and organizing our sticker collections, but now we snuck into her older sister Teresa's room to read through her secret stash of flirty notes from boys who wrote things like, "Girl, you're really sexy," and "You move like a tiger in those jeans." We stole her stacks of magazines, then lay on Soupy's bed and flipped through issues of Teen Beat and Super Teen, ranking the glossy centerfolds in order of cuteness. I guessed that boys our age did the same thing, except with magazines about dirt bikes and hunting, rating engine power and a barrel's cocking action instead of a girl's eyes and the tightness of her pants. Soupy and I practiced hairstyles in front of her bathroom vanity, crimping and curling, teasing and spritzing, like the beauty columns guided us, step by step. Reflected back in the mirror, I stood short and stocky beside Soupy, who was tall, broad-shouldered, and built tough as a hockey player, except she played ringette, the girl's version of the game. Her real name was Julie Sue, but from the time she was a baby, her grandpa called her Soupy, and then everyone else called her that too. Nicknames were a sign of affection, she said, and asked if I had one. But none of the names I'd been called by my dad, Potlicker, Rugrat, Kleine Schwein, which was Low German for short little pig, had stuck. My mother only ever called me Carla, the tone of my name cooling or brightening with her mood and my attitude, which seemed to darken daily, surprising even me. At Soupy's house, I could be a lighter version of my name, unhooked from all the connotations of home. "Why do you always want to go to Soupy's?" my mother said, when I begged for yet another sleepover. "If you're spending the night at her place all the time, people are going to, you know," she cleared her throat, "start to wonder." I couldn't explain how Soupy's house always felt like a holiday, and ours like Monday, like porridge for breakfast, like chores. Even as I slid open my bedroom closet and looked at the clothes that hung, dresses that I hated, blouses too ugly to wear, I was imagining a whole new wardrobe to fit the life I was inventing for myself. Instead of Carla, I could be an Ashley, a Cherie, a Summer, a name whose roots sank down in more exotic ground. By any other name, I'd wake to the sound of a different woman's voice, in a different house, in a place somewhere other than a small town in a valley surrounded by grain fields and forests, lumber mills and logging trucks, and 4x4s revving down the main drag. Instead of a Sunday morning with the hard wooden pews, the dusty old hymns, and a long sermon ahead, it could be an open highway all the way to the ocean, and a shore sparked with sun. These possibilities glimmered in me as I sat at the breakfast table with my bowl of oatmeal and considered my surroundings. Nothing about my mother, brown-haired, green-eyed, freckled, looked like me. Nothing about my father fit, not his love of shoot-'em-up TV westerns and fully loaded Fords, not his zeal for casino jackpots and juicy T-bone steaks. Nothing about my brother, either, whose brain was hooked to numbers and schematics and the lines of code he typed into his Tandy, whose teenage body freely ranged with a pack of guys fixed on ammo, fire, and minor explosions. By another name, Violet, Simone, Raquel, I'd be sipping sparkling juice from a champagne flute, not drinking powdered tang from a plastic co-op tumbler. Instead of the talk around the table being trucks, tools, fuel prices, pigs, the lawn that needed mowing, the weeds to be pulled, the conversation would rise to where on earth I'd love to go, which country I would jet to first, Italy or France, and how the whole world was waiting with an open invitation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.